be seated. Lord be with you. Wrapping up the season of Easter and stepping into Pentecost, the birth of our church by the igniting of the Holy Spirit, and the gospel reading for today takes place during that transition. An aspect of John's theological vision relates to the time when Jesus is no longer among the community. In John's gospel, the Redeemer's work is accomplished with his death. I glorified you on earth, Jesus says to the Father, by finishing the work that you gave me to do. And he says, it is finished on the cross. He is referring to the work for which he was sent by the Father. His time in the world has been a time of revealing the Father's will. His signs have borne witness to the Father's authority. In Jesus' farewell discourse, chapters 13 through 17, prepare for his departure, his death and planned return to the Father. And his farewell discourse summarizes his legacy as he prepares for the passing of the torch to the disciples in the church universal after his death. It ends with a prayer for God's people, which is the gospel reading for today. It's incredibly moving, knowing that Jesus had so much consideration for his community before he left this earth. We see in this passage and also in the Passion narrative how concerned he was for the welfare of his people. And even while Jesus was dying on the cross, he was considering his mother's welfare. We know that he instructed the disciple he loved the most to care for his mother in his absence. In their society, widows were some of the most marginalized people, and Jesus wanted to ensure that she would be cared for. Even in his final moments, he possessed a genuine love and concern for his followers. So we see Jesus crossing his T's and dotting his I's and ensuring that his people had everything they needed before he left. And the concern that he demonstrates for the disciples reminds me so much of the concern that those of you who are parents and grandparents, aunts and uncles have for your children. You raise your children as best as you possibly can, teaching them values, how to make good decisions, how to care for others, how to be good, law-abiding citizens. And when they leave home, you just pray that something stuck. You spend years sowing seeds, and you hope that those values will remain with them. This was his hope for all of us, that something would stick, to the point that we never return to that old life again, that life when we didn't know him or his truth. And as a parent would entrust his or her child into God's care, Jesus does the same. He entrusts the hope for the future of his followers to God in prayer. And his prayer for the community models how the community is to understand and receive its identity in the world. It's to understand that life rests in and depends on God's care. And he places the church's future in the hands of God and invites the church to listen in on that conversation. Jesus hands those who he loves back to God and holds God to his promises for the community of faith. This prayer is personal. It's powerful. It meets each of us where we are. Jesus prayed this prayer thousands of years ago, yet we're connected to it. We're among the individuals he prayed for, and the sovereign grace of God brought forth within this prayer will be felt for generations to come. He begins the prayer. lifting up all the ways in which he glorified God in his time on earth. He glorified the Father simply by obeying him, choosing to honor his will for his life. He glorified God by revealing his power through miracles. We know that he healed the sick, restored vision to the blind, called the dead back to life. And he revealed divine glory by revealing divine power. And God's loving sacrifice of the Son would soon lead to a heavenly glory as well. His glory would resume in heaven once his ministry on earth had ended. And as Jesus prayed this prayer, he was preparing to return to God and enter into this heavenly glory, that his followers would one day have the opportunity to experience for themselves. Later in the prayer, he speaks of God's people with so much confidence. He was certain that he had done everything that he had been called to do for his people. He was also certain that they finally understood. He said to the Father, "For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed." He asked for the help that his loved ones needed at that time in the future. And he goes on to acknowledge the fact that he's leaving their world and requests that his people would be protected, becoming one, as he and his Father are one. In order for his followers to continue living into their purpose, they would need God's protection. But they would need to stick together as well for support. You see, my brothers and sisters, we are united by the Spirit of Jesus that dwells within us. And without cohesion, the church would not survive. We are one, but we can't ignore the fact that we're all different. We're unique in our own way. You are one in a zillion. There's only one of you on this planet, and some of you might be thinking that's probably a good thing. Maybe the world couldn't handle two of you. When we come together as one body, seeing the world through completely different lenses, we come from different families, different backgrounds, different ethnicities. As we seek to unite as one body, our differences can become barriers, or they can empower us to do greater things for God's glory. Jesus prayed this prayer having so much hope and confidence in us to continue doing his work. But we don't see life through his lens. We could try our best to be like Jesus, but we can never be Jesus, because we're human. But together with our gifts and uniqueness, powered by the Holy Spirit, we can continue to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. It takes the entire body of Christ and all of our differences, becoming one in ministry to view the world with the eyes of Jesus. Corinthians 12 says, "For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks. And we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sensitivity of God arrange the members in the body, each of them, as he chose? If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet the body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you, nor again the head to the feet. Way of people who need to experience that love that Jesus has to offer them. We couldn't be the church without our differences. For example, imagine what worship would be like if we were all the same, if we had the same gifts, and were passionate about the same things. Worship would be quite different, I suppose. Even in this moment, as I'm standing here, I can look around at all the differences, the gifts, the passions that make worship so special here. We have our musicians who came to lead us in praise and worship as we seek to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Our safety team came to ensure that we can worship freely and securely. Our Stephen minister came to offer prayer for you. Our ushers and greeters came to meet you with a smiling face. I give thanks for all of them. And for those who came to teach and nurture our children, and youth, for our campus staff, who've set up our classrooms for Sunday school and made our coffee. I praise God for all the gifts represented within our congregation. We each come with a different calling, different interests. Doing a million things, a million different things at the same time, yet we come together as one. And that's truly amazing. We read Jesus' prayer on our particular day and time, in our context, thousands of years after his words were spoken, and it's still providing comfort for us, for God's people, all over the world. And that's because we're still on this journey. We're still trying to figure life out. We're still learning how to love one another authentically, how to trust God completely in every area of our lives. As we journey through this life, we can have the assurance that if no one on this planet is praying for us, Jesus prayed a prayer on our behalf that would last a lifetime. He prayed a very loving and sincere prayer for us, my brothers and sisters, and that should bring us so much joy. After Jesus had done all of those amazing things, transforming lives, giving a voice to the voiceless, encouraging the broken, he chose to be our intercessor as well. Let that empower you to follow him, embracing your uniqueness. that only you can bring to the table. And I encourage you to let God use you in your own special way and take a moment to explore and appreciate the incredibly special people of God surrounding you. Will you lift your hearts and hands to heaven as we go to God in prayer? Gracious Lord, by the power of Christ, your name has been revealed to the people you have called from this world to be in mission and ministry. We are yours. You have called each of us by name. You have embraced us to be your disciples. And we have kept your word. Almighty God, we know that everything you have given to us in our Savior, Jesus Christ, comes only from you. We believe that the words Jesus spoke are your words. And we are committed to listen to your words revealed in Scripture through him. And so it is in the holy name of Jesus that I pray for all of us. I pray for these brothers and sisters that you have called, that we may be one in ministry together for this time and place. You have called us to minister together. Bless us that we be open to the vision that Christ has given not just to those in this place, but to those in other parts of your body, those ministering in your name in other places, in other nations, and in other denominations. For we know that everything you have given through Christ is yours, and everything Christ is came from you. For in Christ you have been glorified. And I pray that the fullness of Christ may be glorified in all of us. Heavenly Father, watch over us in your name. The name you gave your Son Jesus, that we will be one just as you and Christ are one. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. If you've come to this place and you'd like to begin a relationship with Jesus, but you don't quite know where to start, the clergy would love to chat with you immediately following the service. We'd love to answer any questions that you might have about membership as well. If you're in need of prayer, or if you know someone who is in need of prayer, our Stephen minister, Nancy Barnett, will be here at the front to meet you as well. Now let's sing our last hymn together.